हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे द टॉपिक ऑफ लेक्चर इज हाइपरटेंसिव डिसऑर्डर्स इन प्रेगनेंसी। एज वी ऑल नो इट इज़ अ वेरी वास्ट चैप्टर, सो वी आर गोइंग टू डील विद इट इन पार्ट्स एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डील विद पार्ट वन। नाउ इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ हाइपरटेंसिव डिसऑर्डर्स इन प्रेगनेंसी। इट इज़ एसोसिएटेड विद सीवियर मैटरनल ऑब्स्टेट्रिक कॉम्प्लिकेशन, इंसिडेंस इज 5 to 10%, and hypertension in pregnancy is said when systolic blood pressure is more than 140 millimeter of mercury and or diastolic blood pressure is more than 90 millimeter of mercury. Then other criterias where systolic blood pressure rise by 30 millimeter of mercury, diastolic blood pressure increase by 15 millimeter of mercury and mean arterial blood pressure increase by 20 millimeter of mercury. So what is mean arterial pressure? It is systolic pressure plus diastolic pressure into 2 divided by 3, calculated as mean arterial pressure. Then comes classification and definitions. The whole topic is classified as number 1, gestational hypertension. Gestational hypertension where hypertension is present but it is without proteinuria or pathological edema. Then preeclampsia. Preeclampsia is hypertension and significant proteinuria with or without pathological edema. And number 3 is eclampsia. As we all know, what is eclampsia? It is preeclampsia complicated with convulsion and or coma. Then comes chronic hypertension. Chronic hypertension is either essential hypertension or chronic renal disease like renovascular diseases. Then coarctation of aorta, pheochromocytoma, thyrotoxicosis, different types of connective tissue disorders, especially SLE or systemic lupus erythematosus. Then last comes preeclampsia or eclampsia superimposed on chronic hypertension. Now we are going to deal with or elaborate preeclampsia. Preeclampsia is very important topic for all of us. So what is preeclampsia? It is new onset of hypertension after 20 weeks of pregnancy along with proteinuria or end organ dysfunction symptoms or manifestations, followed by return of blood pressure to normal within 12 weeks postpartum. Means it is a multisystemic disorder of unknown etiology characterized by development of hypertension to the extent of 140 by 90 millimeter of mercury or more with proteinuria after the 20th weeks of pregnancy in a previously normotensive and non-proteinuric patient. Preeclamptic features may appear even before 20th week as in cases of hydatidiform mole and acute polyhydramnios. Then what are the different predisposing factors? Number 1 is primi gravida, young age or elderly, it is more than multigravida. Then pre-existing hypertension, family history of either hypertension or preeclampsia or eclampsia or hyperplacentosis, means excessive chorionic tissue as in H-mole, multiple pregnancy, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus and fetal hemolytic diseases. Then obesity, new paternity thrombophilias and like antiphospholipid syndrome, protein C or S deficiency, factor 5 lead in, then placental ischemia, hyperplacentosis, so as I told, multiple pregnancy and rhesus incompatibility, then poor placentation in decreased trophoblastic invasion, these all types of placental abnormalities. These all are the different risk factors or predisposing factors. Then coming to pathophysiology, pathophysiology of preeclampsia. It is very important to understand first the physiology of
normal pregnancy and uteroplacental blood flow in normal pregnancy. So physiology to maintain uteroplacental flow in normal pregnancy, what happens? Placenta releases angiotensinase. Angiotensinase causes destruction of angiotensin 2, which is a potent vasoconstrictor, and so BP is stabilized. Then vascular synthesis of PGI2 and nitric oxide in excess. These are vasodilators, so cause vasodilatation and BP is stabilized and uteroplacental flow is maintained. Then release of vascular endothelial growth factors. These also restore uteroplacental flow. So there is normal balance of agonist and antagonistic factors. First vasodilator, nitric oxide from syncytial trophoblast and endothelium and PGI2 or prostacyclins. And then vasoconstrictor angiotensin 2, endothelin 1 and thromboxane A2, these are decreased. Then comes angiogenic factors like decreased VEGA, vascular endothelial growth factor, TGF-beta and placental growth factor. And angiogenic factors are less in or decreased in synthesis. Now comes, so as we all know, the underlying basic pathology is endothelial dysfunction and intense vasospasm acting almost all on all vessels, especially of uterus, kidney and brain. And responsible agent for dysfunction and vasospasm seems certain to be humoral in origin, as I discussed earlier. Then comes basic mechanism of different organ damage. What happens? To start with, there is increased vasoconstriction, then decreased organ perfusion will be there, increased endothelial dysfunction will be there, leading to capillary leak, edema, leading to edema, pulmonary edema and proteinuria. Then comes activation of coagulation factors, finally leading to DIC and low platelets and hemoconcentration. Features of preeclampsia. In systemic blood vessels, it represents as hypertension because of vasoconstriction. Then in cerebral vessels, it leads to eclampsia. Then in uteroplacental blood supply, or which is finally going to affect the fetus, it leads to intrauterine growth restriction. In kidneys, it comes as glomerular endotheliosis, proteinuria and oliguria. In liver, very important, there is subcapsular leak, ischemia leading to periportal necrosis, and in severe state, it leads to HELLP syndrome, which is very important and I am going to deal with it later. Then in kidneys, there are glomerular endotheliosis leading to oliguria. In lungs, there is pulmonary edema and hemorrhagic bronchopneumonia. Now, etiology of preeclampsia. There is abnormal placentation leading to failure of trophoblastic invasive mediators, then vascular endothelial damage, then inflammatory mediators, as I explained earlier, then immunological intolerance between maternal and fetal tissues, coagulation abnormalities, increased oxygen free radicals, so antioxidants are provided. Some genetic predisposition is also there. Dietary deficiency or excess means imbalance in the proper diet or nutrition. And lastly comes abnormal lipid metabolism, which results in more oxidative stress and so mutation of factor 5 ligand. These all increases the risk. Then what are the different types or clinical types? Clinical classification of preeclampsia is arbitrary and is principally dependent on the level of blood pressure for management purpose. So, categorized as mild and severe. In mild type, it is sustained rise of blood pressure of more than 140 by 90 millimeter mercury, but it is less than 160 systolic or 110 diastolic without significant proteinuria. Then comes severe type. Here a systolic blood pressure of more than 160 millimeter of mercury or diastolic of more than 110 millimeter of mercury with significant proteinuria of more than 3 plus. Headache, other features are headache, epigastric pain and visual disturbances can be present. Thrombocytopenia to less than 1 lakh per mmq, rise in transaminases, SGOT and SGPT. Then health can also be found. Fetal growth retardation is obvious and pulmonary edema is present. From the prognostic point of view, a diastolic rise of blood pressure is more important than the systolic rise. Then comes, as I told you earlier about HELLP syndrome, I am going to elaborate this. So what is HELLP syndrome? It is, HELLP syndrome is an acronym for H for hemolysis, then EL for elevated liver enzymes, and again LP for low platelet count. It is a rare complication of PIH or pregnancy induced hypertension in 10 to 15% of cases. It may be associated even with mild hypertension and proteinuria. This syndrome is manifested by nausea, vomiting, epigastric or right upper quadrant pain, along with biochemical and hematological changes. So criteria for HELLP syndrome, biochemical criteria for HELLP syndrome are LDH more than 600 international unit per ml, means more than 2 times the upper limit of normal value, or bilirubin more than 1.2 milligram per deciliter. AST is more than 70 international unit per liter, means 2 times the upper limit of normal, and platelets less than 1 lakh per microliter. Proteinuria may be present or absent, as I told you earlier. Then management. Principles of management are same as that of preeclampsia or eclampsia, but seizure prophylaxis with magnesium sulfate is started as soon as it is diagnosed. Careful assessment of maternal and fetal status. Administration of corticosteroid improves perinatal maturity, like increases pulmonary maturity, decreases intraventricular hemorrhage and decreases necrotizing enterocolitis. And it helps to the mother as increasing thrombocyte count and increasing urinary output. Caesarean section is the common mode of delivery. Epidural anesthesia can be used safely if the platelet count is more than 1 lakh per mmq. Platelet transfusion should be given if the count is less than 50,000 per mmq. Patient should be managed in an ICU until there is improvement in platelet count. Recurrence risk is very low, that is 3 to 10%. Then comes clinical features. The clinical manifestation usually appears after 20th week of pregnancy. It, as we all know, it is frequently occurs in primi gravidas and more often associated with OPS and medical complications such as multiple pregnancy, polyhydramnios, pre-existing hypertension, diabetes, etc. The onset is insidious in nature and the syndrome runs a slow course. Mild symptoms is it is basically a syndrome of signs, and when symptoms appear, it is usually late. So in mild symptoms, there is slight swelling over the ankles which persist on rising from the bed in the morning, or tightness of the ring on the finger are the earliest manifestations. Then swelling may extend to face, abdominal wall, vulva and even to the whole body. Then comes alarming symptoms. These are usually associated with acute onset of the syndrome, and these are as headache, either located over the occipital or frontal region, disturbed sleep, diminished urinary output to less than 400 ml in 24 hours, epigastric pain, acute pain in the epigastrium associated with vomiting, and at times coffee color hemorrhagic gastritis due to subcapsular hemorrhage in the liver. Then eye symptoms as blurring or dimness of vision, or at times complete blindness, and vision usually regains within 4 to 6 weeks following delivery. Then signs, different types of signs are abnormal weight gain, rise of blood pressure, edema, then pulmonary edema, then abdominal examination, scanty lichen or growth retardation. These all are the different clinical features. Then comes investigation. We do urine examination for proteinuria, pus cells, RBCs, CAS and specific gravity. Then kidney function test is done, and serum uric acid of more than 6 mg% is abnormal, and it is predictor of poor prognosis. Serum creatinine level of more than 1.1 mg/dL. Liver enzymes, AST of more than 70 units per liter, and LDH of more than 600 units per liter. Then hemolysis related results, these are abnormal peripheral smear, indirect bilirubin level of more than 1.2 mg/dL, LDH more than 600. Then coagulation status, we find platelet count less, FDP elevated, PT or APTT decreased fibrinogen, as DIC may develop in acute and severe cases. Then eye fundus examination is done, and tests for fetal well-being are done by ultrasonography, daily fetal movement count and non-stress test. Then about prediction and prevention. So prediction, it is not a preeclampsia is not a totally preventable disease. Somewhat it is found more related to chains of social ills like poor maternal nutrition and no antenatal care, like that. So screening for traditional risk factors like poor maternal nutrition, limited or no antenatal or prenatal care, poor reproductive education, these all are of value, and these cases should be screened. In Doppler's ultrasonography, presence of diastolic notch at 24 weeks of gestation in Doppler in the uterine artery can predict the possible development of preeclampsia. High resistance and when it increases, absence of end diastolic flow or even reversal of flow in the umbilical artery usually indicates poor perinatal outcome. Average mean arterial pressure in second trimester is more than 90 mm Hg, and it can predict the onset. Rollover test done between 28 to 32 weeks, and if there is positive rollover test, chances of developing hypertension are more. What is rollover test? It is blood pressure measurement with the patient on her side first, and then the patient is asked to roll on her back to check the blood pressure once again. An increase of 20 mm Hg in diastolic pressure from side to back position indicates positive rollover test. Then comes prevention. As we all know, in the management of any disease, prevention plays a great role. So here also we have to start with the prevention only. Prevention means first we have to tell the ladies about the significance of regular antenatal visits. Then antithrombotic agents, and especially low dose aspirin can be up to 100 mg daily is suggested. It selectively reduces platelets from thrombogen production. Then calcium supplementation up to 2 g/day is supposed to reduce the risk of preeclampsia. Supplementation with different types of antioxidants, vitamin C, vitamin E, magnesium, zinc, selenium, etc. Helps. Then folic acid, fish oil, algal oil, high protein or low salt diet are also prescribed, but they have been tried but are of limited value. Then comes proper treatment. The treatment is mostly empirical and symptomatic. And objectives are to correct or stabilize the altered physiology, prevention of complications, prevention of eclampsia, delivery of a healthy baby in optimal time with minimum maternal morbidity. So treatment again is divided in prophylactic part and curative part. Prophylactic, it is proper antenatal care to detect high risk cases who may develop PIH, and early detection of cases who have already developed PIH and examine them more frequently. And then comes the role of low dose aspirin. Then curative treatment. It is very important, and it, this aims to prevent or minimize the maternal and fetal complications till reasonable maturity of the fetus. And as I told earlier, primary objective is the safety of mother and then delivery of a healthy baby or healthy newborn. So it is done as general measures. In general measures comes observation. First, maternal observation. Their BP is done, is taken twice daily. Urinary volume and proteinuria is to be done daily. Edema is to be monitored daily. Body weight twice daily. Fundus examination is done weekly. And blood picture including platelet count, LFT and KFT after admission or on admission. Then comes fetal observation. It is done by daily fetal movement count. Then serial sonography, non-stress test, and oxytocin stress test if at all needed. Then comes medical treatment, means different types of drugs or antihypertensive drugs. So antihypertensives of choice are, usually four groups are given. Number one is methyl dopa. It is centrally acting alpha agonist. The dose to start with is 250 milligram 2 to 3 times daily. Then comes labetalol. It is combined alpha and beta blocker. 100 milligram twice daily can be increased to, it can be increased up to 800 milligram in 2 divided doses. Then comes nifedipine. This is calcium channel blocker, and sustained release nifedipine can be given 30 to 60 milligram once daily. Then comes hydralazine, which is peripheral vasodilator, and 10 milligram 4 times daily to start with. Can be increased later on to 10 to 25 milligram BID. And goal of the treatment is to decrease blood pressure to 140 by 90, not less than that. Means the decrease should not be more than, making the blood pressure more than or less than 140 by 90 millimeter of mercury. Then comes obstetric measures. This is very important for delivery part of the management of delivery. So we again have divided it as, the measures are divided as, first timing of delivery to be decided, then method of delivery to be decided, then comes intrapartum care, and finally postpartum care. Timing of delivery depends on the severity of disease, fetal maturity, and condition of the cervix, like means Bishop's pudding. So if the patient is at more than 37 weeks of gestation, we have to deliver without delay, without even second thought. If it is less than 37 weeks, we have to do expectant management at least till 34 weeks. Then comes unstable maternal and fetal condition. In this condition, irrespective of gestational age, we have to deliver immediately. We have to start seizure prophylaxis and steroids if gestation is less than 34 weeks, and as soon as the coverage is done, we have to deliver. Then comes method of delivery or methods of termination of pregnancy. Either it is by induction or by cesarean section. So induction and vaginal delivery may be commenced in what is present here. Here, amniotomy plus oxytocin drip is started if the cervix is favorable and Bishop is okay. If the Bishop is not good or pre-induction Bishop scoring is not very not good, we have to make the cervix ripen by PGE to gel insertion first, and then comes the role of oxytocin and amniotomy. LFT is indicated in indications like in fetal failure of induction of labor and whatever other indications of cesarean section are there. Then comes intrapartum care. Here we have to do close fetal monitoring, proper analgesia to the mother, antihypertensives may be given, and to cut short the second stage of labor by either forceps or vacuum. Then comes finally postpartum care. Methergine better avoided as it increases hypertension. Then maternal observation is continued for at least 48 hours post delivery. Antihypertensives are continued, and
to be tapered on later and finally it is to be stopped. The patient is to be kept in the hospital till the blood pressure is brought down to a safe level and proteinuria disappears. So prophylactic treatment of magnesium sulfate is indicated for all patients with preeclampsia and severe picture, means severe preeclampsia is there. Thank you. If you all have understood the topic, and if you have any query, you can just